Well, friends, hello. Good morning. Welcome to church on Reformation Sunday here at First Presbyterian. We are super, super excited that you all have joined us. I had a clergy friend yesterday who said that he was glad his congregation would be reminded to turn the clocks back an hour because you guys get, so much to your excitement, 1 hour of extra preaching this morning. You took that so
it
much
played,
better.
It played better this time than it did
it was
at
much
first.
Better.
Yeah.
It was much better. We'll let you find out if I'm kidding.
I'm glad you gave it another try.
I did. Just a couple of announcements that we want to get in front of you before we start worship this morning. The first is that next week, November 12th, is Children's Sunday. We move right from Reformation Sunday to Children's Sunday. And there is still room, we've still got space for kiddos to sign up if they would like to participate in leading one of the parts of the liturgy. And so if you are interested in that, talk to me, talk to Jeremy Davis. Jeremy, raise your hand really big. If you want to sign up, talk to Jeremy in the back. He'd love to get your name, and we'll get you all signed up.
Looking forward to Stewardship Sunday in a couple of weeks and want to commend that to you. This morning, a whole other invitation to stewardship is that we will be having an interfaith community service this coming today at 4 o'clock. We'll be celebrating our offering to go toward Pack of Hope, which staves off food insecurity for students in our school district. Everyone who comes to the event will get their own sack of hope to move back out into the world. But as our world theater is full of conflict and difficulty on interfaith relationships, on matters of territory and ethnicity, this interfaith service at 4 o'clock today is a very practical way to engage our community on such important world issues. So we want to commend it to you.
Absolutely. It's going to be a great service. Bit of sad news, or maybe bad news, is that next Saturday was scheduled to be the annual First Pres pig roast. And you might have realized that it rained a little bit recently. The Olson's Ranch sits right on the banks of the Bosque River. And was under about a foot of water for a few days. They've had a ton of debris come down. The roads are blocked. So Charlie called me this past week and said that this was not going to be a good time to do it. So we are officially postponing the pig roast until spring. And we're going to get a date to you as soon as we can. We would love to have you. But no pig roast this coming Saturday, unfortunately.
And a note of warm welcome to our good friends, Fiona Bond, her son Torin Longnecker, and Dr. Bruce Longnecker, who are all with us today, bringing bagpipes to our Reformation service.
We can clap for them, y'all. It's okay. And so in worship, Sunday by Sunday, we come again to the font, carrying pieces and pieces of our lives on our hearts. Today we come to the font remembering the family tumult of one of our own, Donna Fitzpatrick. We come with healing prayers for Dr. Lenore Wright after having shoulder surgery last Friday. We also come with heavy hearts for the loss of family friends, and also for the upcoming procedure that our own clerk of session, Mr. Ken Coons, will have this November. And whatever it is that you have lingering on your heart this morning, bring it before God as together we say at the font,
Welcome home, children of God.
Thank you.
please rise up for the call to worship. Way beyond all the journeying, truth behind all mystery, life within all living. Salve for every soreness, mender of every brokenness, midwife of a better future. Ground of all being, judge of all nations, conscience of the universe. Maker, redeemer, confessor, companion, befriender, inspirer, God beyond all names, we praise you.
Friends, God indeed is the ground of our being, and yet sometimes in life it is easy to feel like that ground has been pulled out from underneath our feet. And so the first thing we do week after week when we come into worship is we raise even those parts of our lives before God. assured that that amazing grace remains with us day by day. So would you join me in our prayer for confession and aspiration? God, you hear us when we fear that we don't have the right words to say. Insecurity and indecision are a heavy burden to carry. So often our lives feel filled with perfect people, and we would prefer it if the living, the praying, and the seeking would be left to those more qualified. Forgive us when neighbors only remind us of our shortcomings, when your call only reminds us of our lack. Give us the courage to inhabit the lives that you have given us. Church, God's goodness is planted deeper inside you than anything in this world could ever take apart. And so rest, be at peace, but rise and share a sign of peace with your neighbor, saying, "The peace of Christ be with you."
Surprise.
Friends, at this time, we're going to invite some of our young friends to, oh no,
Is
Henry before or after?
Henry's before. I want to take a minute inviting you to be seated, and we'll welcome kids. If you're halfway up here,
come on up. We can hear you.
And invite Henry Wright, who is a child at heart in all the right ways, to come forward. He's going to be bringing us a word on stewardship.
Take a seat, take a seat, take a seat.
Do you want to come up here? Stand with, where do you want to be?
Wherever you want to
put me. I'm going to turn that handheld on just in case you need a little extra. Yep.
I have a second communion today. It'll make me especially holy and safe, similar to my approach to laundry. I always put two dryer sheets in the dryer to make it extra soft. I think that's sort of the same thing there. Well, good morning, friends. And I've been asked to speak to you with regards to the issues of giving money and time to the church. We call this stewardship, because we want to make sure you're conscious of the way in which you are dedicating yourself to the missions of the church. The mission that I want to speak to today is regarding youth formation, which we have some well-formed youth, all nicely aligned, but also their spiritual formation and educational formation is important here. I had hoped that I would have my assistant, my young son, Carl Hayes, 9-year-old, who would be here to talk with you because he has a lot of opinions, as one at 9 would have, and he wanted to stay home to help his mother recover and play video games. So we let him stay there, but I did ask him before I left. I said, you know, when you think of the church, what do you love most about the church? And this young, social 9-year-old said he loves coming to church to see his friends. It's like, well, that makes sense. That's what we all have memories of, going and getting together. And I thought, okay, I better ask a little bit more about this to make sure that nothing bad is going on as he's getting together. And I said, well, who are the friends you're meeting up with? And he's like, well, you know, Pastor Leslie and Pastor Chris and Jackie Lott and Bob Lott and Nancy Grayson and the Montoyas and John, the choir director. I was like, wow, that definitely goes into showing one of the things that I always loved about this church is the way it embraces the children as part of its ministry. And the adults recognize that through the children, we're actually learning about our own faith. We've woven that together. Early on, when we first started attending this church, I was always amazed with Children's Sunday, which is coming up next Sunday, that this congregation took so seriously and took such pride in giving the children the opportunity to be the leaders to guide us in our worship, in our faith, and even recognize that we can learn from the youngest of us. So when I think about the importance of stewardship and giving, I think three parts to it. I mean, first, like, well, where am I? What do I have in terms of time and money to give? Sort of a self-assessment. Think a little bit about the future, what is going to happen to me when I give that time and money, and how will I have changed? And the third part is thinking about how my effort, time, money, dedication, is going to shape the community to which I belong. Well, with regards to myself, thinking about this, I inevitably had the opportunity to think back to how this church has now become like my longest home church. And it's seen the baptism of my children. And it's also been the place where my mother was eulogized and Leslie took care of the passing of my brother. So it captures a broad swath of our life experiences. And with that, I also recognize that as it captures the many phases of our life, there's this part of youth development that is a large part of this mission of the church. And we see that we have active Sunday schools for adults, and we are building a youth program. But this mission, this dimension of it, is a time-consuming, expensive part of our mission that I hope that we can find some way to incorporate into our focus for what our community is going to be like in the future. So as you look at how you can be stewards of our church, whether we're doing mission work outside, don't forget about the wonderful mission work that we are responsible for inside the church with the youth here who are going to be able to later on tell stories about this is what formed me into the sort of person I am. So basically, in summary, it's the idea that we have a place that has as its strength a love of children, the care and attention to them that sees them as educators for us to learn from. But we also are going to have to shoulder the financial and time commitment burdens to see that this is a program that is going to be healthy and growing and sustaining within our church. So with that, those are my words. Pastor Leslie, get the mic back. Thank you.
And the mic now goes to welcoming forward Mr. Jim Maxwell.
Friends, so today we are celebrating something called, do we have that microphone? Can I start for me 1 second, Jim? We're celebrating something called Reformation Day. JJ, can you give me a try? Can you say Reformation Day?
Reformation Day.
Can you guys all say that? Reformation Day. And what we do, here you go, my friend, is when we talk about Reformation Day, is we talk about the history of this place, right? Every family has a history, right? Maybe you have a friend who does a family tree, and they can trace their family all the way back down through the ages. And so if we were going to do that as Presbyterians, there are two places that we would need to look. Where do you think Jim comes from? Take a guess. JJ, what do you think?
JJ, here's a microphone for you. Say something nice. You've got a book in your
mind. Where do you think Jim's from?
Do you have questions for Jim?
Yeah.
What's your question? Do you have a question, Hannah?
Were you ever a pirate?
Do you want to answer his question?
Was I ever a pirate?
Yeah.
No, but I had those inclinations from
time. You have those inclinations. Hannah, what's your question?
You look like you're wearing pajamas and your real clothes.
Are they your pajamas, Jim?
They are not my pajamas. They would be uncomfortable to sleep in, I think.
Are you just dressed up to volunteer in the church today, or are you really a professional music player?
I'm wearing this today just in recognition of the fact that this is Reformation Day and that our church, the Presbyterian Church, began in Scotland 500 years ago. And churches, Presbyterian churches around the world, recognize their Scottish heritage, especially on Reformation Day, because that was when we began. And while the church has changed a lot over the years, we look back to those Scottish roots. And so every once in a while we wear these, and there's an old Scottish tradition of these tartans. This is called a tartan, and that's the fabric. And those represent different families or groups. And for hundreds of years, Scottish people have taken little pieces of this tartan and carried it with them when they went to church, and they tuck it into their socks or their purse or their pocket. And then at some time during the church service, they would reach in and they would touch that little bit of cloth and say special prayers that God would take care of their families. And so there's a big connection between the church and families, and between Scottish families and the Presbyterian Church.
Hmm. Beautifully said. And Jim, so tell us about your tartan. Where did you get this tartan?
This tartan? This is the Maxwell tartan. And the Maxwell family began in Scotland about 900 years ago with a guy named Herbert, who became known as Herbert de Macclesfield. And in French, Herbert de Macclesfield. And that is French for Herbert was the name, but then D of. And he lived by a salmon pool that was on land that had been owned by a guy named Maccas. And in Scottish Gaelic, a salmon pool is called a wheel. And so he was known as Herbert of Maccas's wheel. And that was shortened after
Maxwell. Wow. That's amazing.
What does the pin mean down here?
There's a story behind that, but it's just purely decorative.
Yeah.
Just purely decorative.
And Jim, I know that often Scottish families of significant names, they get a castle. Isn't that kind of cool? You get a castle. So if we wanted to go to the Maxwell Castle, where in Scotland would we go?
It's just south of Dumfries, and it's called Calaveroch. And Calaveroch is Gaelic for lark's nest.
Lark's nest?
Yeah, the lark's nest.
Oh my gosh, amazing. So. Well guys, what do you think? Can we thank Mr. Jim for coming up and for teaching us a little bit? Thank you.
I think you should say our prayers.
my heart. God be on my left. God be on my right. God be beneath me. God be above me. God be in the faces of all who love me. All right, so stay right where you are. I have one more friend that I want to introduce you to as you make your way out to Children's Church. There's one more person that we have to thank for being Presbyterian, and his name is John Calvin. And I actually have him here. You know how old he is? He's 500 years old. Isn't that crazy? John Calvin, can you come out here, please? This is my friend John, everybody. And you are going to go with John, and you're going to go with Miss Jamie. This might scare the heck out of you. I'm sorry. He's really nice. I'm going to give you a little secret. He's only dressed up as John Calvin. That's really nice. And you guys are going to go to Children's Church. Good? All right. Thanks, John. We're going this way, y'all. You can follow Miss Jamie right out that door.
There are so many reasons to pray right now. Let's do that. Gracious God of our history, of our present moment, of the strength of our future, we soften our heart and mind to welcome fully your Spirit, your living word, that we may continue to be reformed by your presence in our lives. These things we pray, each in our own way, as we beseech the Holy Spirit. Amen. A reading from Psalm 107, verses 1 to 7, and then the 33rd verse through the 37th. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for the Lord's steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west and from the north and the south. Some wandered in desert wastes, finding no way to an inhabited town. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted within them. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way until they reached the inhabited town. He turns rivers into a desert, springs of water into thirsty ground, a fruitful land into a salty waste because of the wickedness of its inhabitants. He turns a desert into pools of water, a parched land into springs of water, and there he lets the hungry live. And they establish a town to live in. They sow fields and plant vineyards and get a fruitful yield. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh, rain of God.
Friends, you may be seated. Thank you. Our second reading from Scripture comes to us from the New Testament, from Paul's letter to the Roman Church, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Hear these words spoken to you and to me. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you might discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in the body we have many members, and not all of the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ. Individually, we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Struck when during the week I received an email in my inbox from one in our congregation, from someone who I know to be a very honest and thoughtful person, a person who cares deeply about the church, even though they have only recently come to love it. They sent me an article that was entitled, "To Reach Gen Z, Faith Leaders Must Go Back to the Basics." So I was really excited when this person agreed to meet with me this week over coffee so that I could get a sense of what had pricked their imagination about this article. They're a person who I know has children that would fit the Gen Z description. And so we sat there and our conversation crescendoed. We wove our way through the various questions that the article raised until eventually I felt like our entire conversation led to one question that this man asked me. "Chris," he asked, "what does faith mean for someone living in the 21st century? And often I feel, friends, that the best questions that we can ask often lead to the most inadequate of answers. And so I think I tried to posit maybe two or three very inadequate answers to his question, "What does faith mean?" But I have a guess that even though he was writing well before the 21st century, that if you were to ask St. Paul what he thought about that question, "What does faith mean?" that he might well have read for you the words that he penned to that Roman church. You see, some have called this letter to the Romans the first work of systematic theology ever written. That is, that it's a work that tries to synthesize, that tries to summarize the entirety of what the gospel is in only 16 short chapters. For the first 11 chapters, Paul reminds us why he was at the top of his class in rabbinical school. He weaves us through an intellectually rigorous argument about why Jesus came why sin and death feel so near to us. He weaves us through all of those big seminary words, words like Christology and soteriology, pneumatology and eschatology. He tells us what has happened to the world because of Jesus Christ. But of course, Paul is smart enough to know that intellectual arguments by themselves don't change the world. But if you want to change the world, then you have to change the human heart. And so in chapter 12, Paul pivots in a way, and he stops teaching us about the what, and he tells us about the why. He tells us why it matters in the first place and what it means. He tells us the powers of evil and of death and of hatred, as close as they can feel to us week by week, that the world has somehow been changed so that we might ourselves be changed. See, faith for Paul, I don't think it's a multiple choice test. I don't think faith is a litany of things that we ought or ought not to believe. It's not just a rubric for ranking human righteousness, but faith is the conviction that somehow, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that we human beings can be changed. That our minds might conform to the mind of Christ. That faith, in the simplest of terms for Paul, is the conviction that God moves in the world. Yet I wonder if sometimes it's the simplest truths like this that are the hardest to believe. How often is it that in our moments of frustration that we cast up our hands and change seems impossible, and we utter those words, nothing will ever change. There's a famous theologian in the 20th century, his name was Paul Tillich. Paul Tillich once said that he thought that the opposite of faith was not doubt, but that the opposite of faith was certainty. And if I wanted to quibble just a little bit with Professor Tillich, I think I might say that the opposite of faith isn't certainty, but the opposite of faith is cynicism. When the world's changelessness feels inevitable, when we feel stuck in perpetuity, sometimes I think the bedrock of our despair is the thinking that the world can't and won't change for the better. But of course, the irony, dear friends, is that we often are least likely to notice when the world is changing under our feet. When we are changing, or even when we have been changed. Let me give you an example. The year was 1862. It was the year before this church would call its first full-time pastor in the person of Samuel King. The Southern Presbyterian Church in the year of 1861 had broken off with the Northern Church, and in the year 1862, they sent a letter to the General Assembly in the Church of Scotland attempting to credence the Confederacy's secession from the Union. They tried to give a biblical justification for chattel slavery. It was a time of damning moral failure. And in due time, the Southern churches received their reply from that Scottish kirk. I'm going to paraphrase it for you. Whatever you're doing down there, it demands not God's grace, but God's judgment. But friends, grace upon grace has been given to us. That we are not the same people, that our communities are not the same, that we have slowly, if anything, been changed. I'm convinced that it's not merely intellectual moral arguments or the widening of our circles of empathy that has brought this about, but it is the work of the Holy Spirit in our midst that has melded us, that has formed us, that has shaped us down through the ages. And that somehow the miracle of what faith means for Paul is that even our living and even our failing can be placed on the altar of God's grace and God's mercy. But in doing so, we won't be the same. What does faith mean? Maybe in somehow its barest form, faith is the courage to believe that change is possible, that change is When I served a church in Scotland, there was a member of that church. Her name was Pat McClellan. Pat McClellan, and she lived in a tiny coastal town named Auchnithy, right north of the church where I served. She had this beautiful home that opened up onto the cliffs that dropped off into the North Sea. She was a deeply curious woman, and every time I would go to her house for tea, she would give me another book. And I would come back and we'd talk about it. One of the books that she gave me was by a Scottish clergyman named Murdo MacDonald, affectionately known as Padre Mac. Padre Mac. And in his autobiography, Padre Mac tells this story about being a prisoner during World War II. It didn't take long once the war broke out that he signed up for the 1st Parachute Brigade in the British Army and eventually was captured while fighting in Africa and taken to the Stalag-Luft prison. Now the prison, he says, had a large fence that ran through the middle of it, the fence that separated the Americans from the British soldiers, but Padre, being the good man of the cloth that he was, volunteered to be the chaplain for the Americans. Lord knows who he is. But what he didn't know is that the Americans had smuggled in a radio into their side of the camp and were receiving communications for the front lines, even when everything was going wrong for the Germans as the Allied forces got closer and closer to Berlin. So every day at noon, Padre would walk to the middle of that fence where he would be greeted by another one of his Scottish companymen. The guards would watch him closely. Now remember, those guards spoke French. They definitely spoke German. Some of them even spoke English. They had one problem. They didn't speak Scots Gaelic. So in Gaelic, these Scottish countrymen would communicate over that fence about the progress that the war was making, until one day that news came, finally, that the war was over, even before the soldiers knew it. And so in the middle of that day, guns pointed at them, eating that gross prison food, the prisoners erupted into laughter and into celebration. That joy and praise rang out from the halls of that prison that day. Now, if you would have taken a photograph to look at how their situation would have changed, it wouldn't have changed much. The guards still manned the entrance to the prison. They still had to live in the cramped and cold lifestyle, which they did. Yet in some way, everything had changed for them now, because the Allies would be there soon. It was only a matter of time. So what does faith mean for us today? Maybe it's not all that different from what it meant for St. Paul. That faith, like it was for those prisoners, was the confidence that the world had been turned upside down despite their current conditions. It was the courage to believe that we, yes, even we, can be different people even when our cynicism tells us the opposite. That faith is, whether you know the saying, reformed and always reforming. Maybe even more accurately, reformed and always being reformed. Amen. It's now saying together what it is we believe. We borrow the words from John Knox in the Scots Confession of 1560. Please rise if you are able. We confess and acknowledge one God, to whom we cleave, whom we serve, whom we worship, and in whom we put our trust. God is eternal, infinite, unmeasurable, incomprehensible, omnipotent, invisible, one in substance, yet distinct in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We confess and believe all things in heaven and earth, as well visible and invisible, to have been created, to be retained in their being, and to be ruled and guided by God's inscrutable providence. Our lives find their end in God's eternal wisdom, goodness, and justice, as God has appointed them, to the manifestation of his own glory. You may be seated. Thank you. And at this time, we'll invite our ushers forward to receive our offerings. Friends, come again to the table of grace where Christ waits for us. No matter where you come from or what this week has held for you, know that you are welcome here. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It's right to give our thanks and praise. Let us pray. It is indeed right and wonderful to be able to articulate, to consider, to offer back our gratitude. So for the height of the cosmos, the mystery of all the planetary systems and stars, we offer our thanks. For the substantive responsibility to stand in the place that we are and care for the world around us, to reach to our right and to our left, sharing in leadership, civic duty, and faithful practice, we give you thanks. For all that lies beneath what is visible for us on the human heart, within the musings of the mind, within languages foreign to our own, we give you thanks when there is understanding, when there is shared experience. So may our shared experience of this sacrament provide us stamina for our journey, well-being in our relationships, and high hope upon the horizon of your transcendence. These things we offer as we ready ourselves for the ordinary elements to your extraordinary ends. Amen. Everything's ready. We want to invite our communion servers forward. Oh, not quite. Yeah. On the night of his arrest, he did not forget about the bread. He picked it up. He broke it open. He said, "This bread is as my body. Whenever you partake of it, do this remembering me."
And after supper, he took a cup of wine and he poured it out for them, raising it to heaven and blessing it. passing it around and saying, take and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant sealed for all people in my blood. And every time you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Leslie and I would like to invite the communion servers forward as we prepare for the sacrament.
This morning's sacrament will be served by intinction, and there'll be an opportunity for each of you to arrive up. We'll be serving the communion servers first, that they may adequately share with you. I need Christ, Michelle, for you. I need Christ, Dave. Those communion servers holding the bread will tear off a piece for each of you. And if it's most convenient for you to be served where you're seated, Michelle and Kitty will be around to provide you those elements. All is ready. Bread of heaven, Lynn and Peggy, for you. Awesome. Bread of heaven. Lord, God's portion for you, Eloise, Steve. Thank you.
be seated.
Let us close with that prayer taught to us down through the ages, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. But deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now it's your privilege and mine to go out into this world in peace that has always required courage, that we might hold fast to what is good, return no person evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering, and in so doing, honor all people, rejoicing in the Holy Spirit.
Any of it, and perhaps all of it, is possible because there is a God who is always ahead of us, a Christ who has befriended us and a Spirit that dwells within us. Amen. Go in peace.